Good afternoon to all of you. Thanks for coming. I think I saw most of you already on Monday, but just in case if not, I'm Daniel Diermeier. I'm the Dean of the Harris School. And I think my tenure is about 3 weeks longer than when you started. So we're all kind of here starting almost at the same time. It's my great pleasure to welcome you tonight to the Aims of Public Policy lecture. And what this is, the idea is really is to give you an example of the rigorous type of policy analysis that we pride ourselves here at the Harris School. It's not the only way to do it, but you'll see it is a particularly paradigmatic way to do public policy analysis that you'll hear tonight. And our speaker who will do this for us is Professor Jeff Grogger, who is sitting right there. He is the Irving Harris Professor in Urban Policy here at Chicago Harris. He's an applied microeconomist by training who has really worked in a whole variety of different policies areas, anything ranging from crime, education, mobility, racial inequality, whole variety of different areas. He's done work everything from the estimating the deterrence effect of the death penalty to looking at the consequences of welfare reform. And indeed, among the many other publications, one of his most recent ones is his co-authored book on welfare reform, Effects of a Decade of Change, which was published by Harvard in 2005, I believe, right? Good. So, one of the pleasures of becoming a new dean here at the University of Chicago and at the Harris School is that you learn about the works of one's colleagues. So I had the great pleasure of a meeting with all my faculty colleagues over the last few weeks. And it's always amazing what you discover. So when Jeff and I were talking, we discovered that we both have an interest in the consequences, policy consequences of obesity. Very different angle, very different interest, but both have looked at this issue at different points of our careers, and Jeff is engaged in a very large project on that. And then we both have an interest in language, and in language both in the policy process or in the political process on my side. And I have looked at a variety of different things, and Jeff had looked at that from a completely different point of view, and that's what he will speak to you about today. So his theme today will be, there you have it, speech in the labor market. He will give his remarks, and then we're going to open it up for some questions and comments, so you should get ready for that already. Make sure you have some thoughtful, insightful, never mind. Okay, Jeff, take it away. Let's join in welcoming Jeff Grogger.
Thank you. All right, thank you, Daniel. I'm delighted to have the opportunity tonight to give the Aims of Public Policy address and to extend my personal welcome to the MPP class of 2016. You've probably been welcomed a lot. It's okay, you can't overdo it. So what I want to do tonight, I want to talk about, as Daniel suggested, I want to talk about some of my recent research. In fact, this is hot off the presses. And then I want to use that as an example to talk about policy questions and how we might think about policy questions. So let's start. So the first thing, if we want to talk about speech in the labor market, the first question I want to ask is, well, what do we know already about language? And the answer is a lot. But you don't have to take this from me. You can take this from somebody who spends all of his time thinking about language. I'm not sure if you can read it, so I'll read it. It says, language has fascinated people for thousands of years, and linguists have studied every detail, from the number of languages spoken in New Guinea to why we say razzle-dazzle instead of dazzle-razzle. So this is from Steven Pinker. Now, I would say, and it's true, there's just sort of volumes or libraries that have been written on language, but it turns out there are still a couple of important questions that are outstanding. So we may know how many languages there are in New Guinea, we may separate the razzle from the dazzle, but there's a couple of questions that I think are very important and worth asking. And that's what I'm trying to do. So the first question seems very basic. How does a worker's speech affect her labor market chances? The second question, I think, is more surprising, and that is, whether economic incentives influence the way a worker speaks. Now, so it turns out that we actually know a little bit about the first question. We know this from the literature on migration. And what we know is that migrants who speak the language of their host country do better economically than their counterparts who don't. And furthermore, we know the better the migrant speaks that host country language, the better she does in the labor market. Okay, but as important as the migration issue is, 97% of the world's population lives in the country in which they were born, right? So it suggests there's a whole lot that's left to know about the relationship between speech and labor market opportunities. Okay, so with that, let me provide some background on speech. So there are two key questions here. So where does variation in speech come from? That's question number one. And the second question is, what determines how we speak our native language? Because today I'm going to be talking about speech, how one speaks one's native language. Okay, now, variation in speech comes from variation in dialect. Different speakers of the same language speak different dialects. And the work that I am going to focus on today is very importantly, so essentially what we're doing is we're making use of two very important, very widespread and recognizable dialects of American English, one of which is called African American Vernacular English, and one of which is called Southern American English. Okay, now, so what do we know about these dialects? Well, like all dialects, African American Vernacular English, Southern American English are rule-based grammatical systems. As is the case with all dialects that depart from the standard, it's just that the rules are different from the rules of the standard, okay? The other interesting thing, and the other important thing, is that both AAVE and Southern American English differ from Standard American English in terms of two components of language. One is called phonology and one is called morphology. Now, what is phonology? Phonology is basically how sounds sound, and in particular, how we produce vowels. That's probably the most important component of it. Morphology, this is the part of grammar that has to do with subject-verb agreement, with plural marking, with possessive marking, all of that stuff that deviled you when you took French or German or Spanish or Chinese or whatever it was that you took in high school or college. Okay, so both of these dialects have different rules for phonology and morphology than Standard English has. Now, they share some rules in common, not all of them. The other thing that's important to understand is that speakers of these dialects, like speakers of all dialects everywhere, do not strictly speak, you know, one dialect versus the standard. So it's not as if we either speak a dialect or we speak Standard English. Most speakers mix terms from their native dialect and terms from Standard English as well. Sometimes they do this because of context, sometimes they just do it. Okay? So that's what we know. So this is sort of like the basic background on spoken language that you need to know to get to the questions that I'm interested in. Oh, except for this. What determines how we speak our native language? So this is pretty interesting. And one of the things that's interesting about this is that evidence from two very different disciplines points to the same thing. There's agreement from both sociolinguistics and from neuroscience. And that is that there is a sensitive, some would call it critical, but I'll call it a sensitive period for accent acquisition. And the one's native accent is acquired from one's linguistic peers during that sensitive period. Okay, so next question, what is the sensitive period? There's a little bit of variation in the literature, but pretty much all accounts agree, the sensitive period for language acquisition, particularly accent acquisition, ends by the time the speaker reaches puberty. Okay, so phonology may be set earlier, it may be set as earlier, so 6, 7, 8 years old, morphology may be a little later, but the whole thing is over by the time you reach puberty. Now, what this means, oh, and furthermore, the other thing that's important here is that we learn our accent from our linguistic peers, which is to say, the kids we speak with during that period. Now, as a thought experiment, think about your favorite immigrant, or it could be your favorite child of an immigrant. So in my case, my favorite child of immigrants is my wife. Now, neither of her parents sounds American. They're both very fluent, one could even say powerful speakers of English. Neither one sounds the remotest bit American. Well, my wife was born here, so she sounds like she could have grown up down the street from me. Okay, so just as a thought experiment, as a way of telling you, as a way of sort of reinforcing this idea, we obtain our native accent from our linguistic peers, and basically we've obtained it by the time we hit puberty. Now, why is this important? Well, after the sensitive period is over, it is difficult to acquire a native-sounding accent in a second language. So, and from the literature that exists, we think this is also true for second dialects. So a lot of what we know about the way we speak, a lot of the reason why I'm talking like this, is because people who I lived near and people who I spoke with when I was, say, 8 to 10 years old talked like this. Okay? And that's true for dialects, for all dialects. Okay, so where do we go with this? Now, the next thing we need to think about, what do you need to know in order to analyze the relationship between speech and wages? Well, you need data on wages and you need data on speech. Where do we get data on wages? This turns out to be the relatively easy thing to do. This is something Wage data are collected by the Census Bureau. They're collected by the Bureau of Labor Statistics. They're also collected by NORC, our neighbor in the 1155 East Building. And in fact, I'm going to make use of wage data that were collected by NORC as part of something called the National Longitudinal Survey of Youth. And I'll spare you the details, but the thing to think about is the NLSY, as I'll call it, consists of people. It was originally a representative sample of people who lived in the United States. They're all about age 30 now. They're all about just between, say, certainly between age 25 and age 30. So that's where the wage data come from. Now, what about data on speech? What does that even mean? Okay, how do you collect data on speech? There are a number of things that you could do. I did something I think is very simple. I am going to ask, or I asked, survey respondents. These are the people who are the respondents in the NLSY. These people who I'm also going to call speakers. I asked them questions to elicit speech. So I asked them a question, and I hope that they would talk for a minute. Most of them did. I then have other people, who I refer to as listeners, listen to recordings of that speech. And after they listen to the recording, they're going to answer three questions. What was the speaker's sex? What was the speaker's race or ethnicity? And where is the speaker from? Okay, now, there's a lot of study about the extent to which listeners can identify the sex, race, and region of speakers based on their voice. And what I know from that literature is that there's a lot of variability. There are regularities, but there's also variability. So instead of having just one listener listen to each speaker, I had a number of listeners listen to each speaker. So I want to look for agreement between the listeners. And specifically, I had six listeners listen to each of the speakers, okay, and provide information here about the speaker's sex, race, and region. Now, the next question you might have is, well, how well do the listeners do? So it turns out for sex, the listener identification is almost automatic. Something like 98% of the listeners got the sex of the speaker correct. And there's sort of obvious biological reasons for that. The more interesting question is, how well did they do in terms of race and ethnicity? Because in some sense, this is kind of what makes the whole study go. Region two. Okay, so let's take a look. Now, what I have here is a frequency distribution of the number of listeners who perceived the respondent to be black. When I asked them, what is the race of the speaker? They said the speaker is black. And here we're only focusing on black respondents. So the correct answer was that the speaker is black. So here's some of the variation. If I step away from the microphone, can you hear me? Okay, I haven't found a room too big yet. Okay, let's look at this end of the frequency distribution first. What does this tell us? This says that there were 5.5% of the speakers whose voices were such that none of the six listeners perceived them to be black. Okay, that's one end of the spectrum. What about the other end? Over here, what this bar tells us is that there were 32.6% of the black speakers, about a third of the black speakers, whose voices were such that all six of the respondents perceived all six of the listeners perceived the speaker to be black. Okay, so there's a distribution here, but you'll notice that a preponderance of the data loads on 4, 5, or 6. So, and this is consistent with other studies of identification of the speaker's race by voice. So it's not altogether surprising. Now, so I could work with this data as it is, but it turns out for some of the things that I want to do, it turns out to be much more useful if I simplify things. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make some definitions. Whoops. So what I'm going to say, I'm going to dichotomize that data, which means that what I'm going to say is that the worker is perceived as black, or shorthand, the worker sounds black, if four or more of the listeners reported that the speaker was black. Now remember, I'm looking at African-American speakers as an example here, but remember that I'm also doing this for perceptions of the speaker's region. Okay? So I'm going to say that a worker is perceived as Southern, simply put, sounds Southern, if four or more of the speakers said that the speaker was Southern, based on his voice. Okay, and then finally, what I'm going to say is, and this is just for terminology, I'm going to say that workers who do not sound black and workers who do not sound Southern have what I'm going to call favored speech. Right? And so the question is, how many workers have favored speech? Well, it turns out about 28% of the African Americans in the sample have favored speech, and about 68% of the Southern whites have favored speech. So another way to say this is about 32% of the Southern whites sound as if they were Southern. There was a lot of agreement, among the listeners that those Southern whites were Southern. Okay, so now let's look now at data on speech and wages. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to focus on the wages of African Americans and Southern whites. Now, in fact, I do the analysis for everybody. For our purposes today, I want to focus on African Americans and Southern whites, and I'm going to restrict attention to males who are out of school. And so these are guys who are working for a living. Okay? Now, so here's data on wages. What are you looking at? You're looking at the relative wage gap between black men and non-Southern white men according to the perception, the listener's perception of the black worker's speech. So what this means is there's a reference group out there that's going to be non-Southern white men. To the wages of non-Southern white men, I'm going to compare two groups of African Americans. One, the group that were perceived as black on the basis of their voice, they get the blue bars. The other are those who were not perceived as black on the basis of their voice. They get the red bars. And so I've got three sets of results here, three pairs of bars, three sets of results, and I want to walk you through them, tell you what they say. This very first set says no controls. Here all I'm doing is comparing wages. We can read these numbers as roughly approximately percentage differences. So what this number tells me is that the wages of young African American men who sound black are on average 24% less than the wages of the non-Southern white reference group. Now what does this say? This tells me that the wages of African American workers who do not sound black earn 5.6% less than the Southern white reference group. Okay, so we see racial disparities in both cases. Clearly those disparities differ a lot by speech status. This difference between the red and the blue bar, I'm going to refer to as the speech-related wage gap, the speech-related wage differential, something like that. And so what we see here is in the raw data, the speech-related wage gap is something like 18%. Okay, now, that's a big number, but we know that we can't stop here, right? There's a lot of theory, human capital theory, for example, that tells us that wages are related to things besides race and speech. They're related to education, they're related to experience, and we also know empirically that there's variation in wages by region depending on where you currently live. So in this next set of results here that's labeled basic controls, what I do is I adjust for those basic human capital characteristics. And this adjustment matters. When I adjust for human capital, I estimate that the wages of black men who sound black are about 14% less than the wages of non-Southern white men. The wages of black men who don't sound black are about 2% less. Okay, so that's a big difference. Human capital matters. Notice it still leaves a very large speech-related wage gap. It's on the order of 12 percentage points. Okay, now where do we go from here? Well, you might think that these sort of basic human capital measures, education, experience, are not the only things that might affect speech on the one hand, wages on the other. Things like family background, things like family income, things like parents' education, all of these things may play a role in influencing how we speak as well as our earnings power once we finish school. So in this last set of results, I add those kind of family background characteristics to the basic human capital controls. And what do I find? Well, they help narrow the gap some, but they don't get rid of it. So now, after all this adjustment, we see that African American men who are perceived as black on the basis of their voice still earn about 10% less than the non-Southern white reference group. And now we see that the black men who don't sound black earn about a percentage point more. Okay, so adjustment matters a lot sort of in terms of the absolute levels, but notice that we still end up with a sizable speech-related wage premium. It's still on the order of 10, 11 percentage points. Okay, now, but I promised that I would do this for Southern speech as well as for African Americans. So here the results are a little different, qualitatively similar. The layout here is exactly the same. The blue bars pertain to white Southern men who are perceived as Southern on the basis of their voice, who sound Southern. The red bar pertains to Southern men who don't sound Southern. So what do we see? In the raw data, Southern men who sound Southern earn about 13% less than non-Southern white men. Southern men who don't sound Southern earn 3.9% more. What happens when we adjust for human capital? The Southern men who sound Southern now earn 6% less than the non-Southern white men. And the Southern men who don't sound Southern earn 4.5% more. We adjust for family background, there's a further narrowing of the difference, but we still end up with an 8 percentage point speech-related wage differential. So if we just compare the wages of white Southerners who sound Southern to the wages of white Southerners who don't sound Southern, there's an 8 percentage point gap. Oh, and I should say, for those of you who know about stuff like this, this is all, these speech-related wage gaps are all statistically significant. Okay, now, next question is, do I care about these numbers? Are these big numbers? Are they small numbers? How do I think about these things? Well, one way to get a handle on this is to compare these numbers, this 8 percentage point wage gap for Southern speech, about a 10 percentage point wage gap for African-American speech, African-American sounding speech, to something we know. Well, we know a lot about the returns to education, for example. And I think a consensus estimate of the return, the gross return to an additional year of education, would be about 7%. So both of these numbers here are larger than the return to an additional year of schooling. So these are pretty big. Okay, now, I want to come back to these speech-related wage differences in a minute when I talk about policy. But I want to move in a slightly different direction now. So there seems to be a premium associated with favored speech. For an economist, the next question is, do workers respond? Another way to say this is behavior as basic as speech influenced by economic incentives? Now, that may sound like a crazy idea, but it's pretty consistent with basic economic theory. Because basic economic theory tells us this: when price rises, supply should increase. Well, what's the price in this case? Well, it's the wage premium for favored speech. What's supply? Supply is the share of workers with favored speech. Okay, so what I'm asking here again, do economic incentives influence workers' speech? How do you test this? What I'd like to do is estimate the speech-related wage premium in every labor market where my survey respondents live, and then I would like to relate whether they have favored speech to that speech premium. Okay, so data limitations don't let me quite do that, but what they do let me do is they let me estimate separate speech-related wage premia for, it says, each state. I should say a number of states. Okay? And then what I'm going to ask is whether more workers have favored speech in states with higher speech premia. And I'm going to do this analysis now separately for African Americans and for Southern whites. And to summarize the results, what I see is that a 10 percentage point increase in the speech premium increases favored speech by about 2.4 percentage points. Okay? For Southern white workers, I see, at least nominally, a bigger response. A 10 percentage point increase in the speech premium increases favored speech by 5.5 percentage points. But this result is not statistically significant. And the reason is there just aren't that many states where I can estimate a separate premium for Southern speech. Okay? But anyway, so that's what happens sometimes. Okay, now. So this is sort of interesting. But what I want to do now is I want to go back to this idea that wages vary according to speech. And I want to think about policy. And what I really want to do is I want to think about how to think about policy. Okay? And here's why. So my guess is most of you are unaware how important speech was in influencing wages. I've written one paper on this before. Unless you read that, you probably weren't aware of that. Okay, now, and you might ask yourself, am I surprised? Well, it's kind of surprising. But then on the other hand, you say, well, we know that inequality is rampant, right? It's been rising. There's lots of it out there. It's itself a public policy issue. At some level, should we be surprised that there's inequality that manifests itself along lines of speech? Not sure. But here's what I'm guessing. here's what I'm guessing. At least some of you are discomforted by the idea that how much you earn may be related to how you speak, which, based on what we know from linguistics, is related to who it was we were talking to when we were, what, 8, 9, 10 years old. You don't have to raise your hand or anything. Okay, here's the other thing I'm thinking, because I know you're public policy students. I know some of you are thinking, what do we do about this? And that's what I want to talk about now. What should we do? Well, what are things that we could do? One thing we could do, we could provide speech instruction. We could provide extra instruction in standard English for people who grow up speaking a non-standard dialect. That's one thing we could do. That's one way we could intervene. What else could we do? We could ban speech discrimination. We've banned discrimination on all sorts of grounds. We could ban it on the basis of speech. But here's a question I really want to ask. Is this the right question? Okay, why am I asking this? The way I think about this is there are questions that we have to answer first. And this is supposed to be about the aims of public policy. So what I will say is, in my view, one of the aims of public policy education is that by the time that you leave here in a couple of years, you'll automatically be thinking about this as you confront new potentially troubling policy issues. So let's think about the kinds of questions that we have to address before we can even think about sound policy formulation. Okay, so the first is seemingly obvious, but it is, are we observing a cause and effect relationship? The second is there a market failure? I know some of you have never even heard that term before. It's okay, that's why we have economics. I'll talk about it in a minute. Okay, if there's not a market failure, is there a case for redistribution? And finally, I don't know if this is special to my list, but I think we need to ask ourselves whether history has any lessons for us before we proceed. So let me talk about these in turn. And here, I want to use speech as an example, but I think these are questions that we have to address when we confront any policy issue. It's not limited to the speech question. Okay, now, cause and effect. Does the observed relationship reflect cause and effect? This has to be the most basic question in the world, right? But I guarantee you, when you go home tonight or tomorrow and you read, I don't know, the New York Times, The Economist, Slate, whatever it is that you like to read, wherever you get your information, if you read carefully, what you will find is that there are all sorts of policies that are proposed and all sorts of policies that are defended on the basis of empirical information that has nothing to do with cause and effect. You want a great example, completely whimsical, but it helps illustrate the point? Here's what happens. If you look at data over the last couple hundred years, you find there has been a great reduction, recent decade notwithstanding, a great reduction in the number of pirates operating on the high seas. It's true. Here's what else you find. Global average temperatures have been rising dramatically. There is a strong statistical relationship between the number of pirates and global temperatures. Okay, now, the good news is this example is preposterous enough that nobody has thought that really what we ought to be doing is subsidizing those guys in Somalia so they'll be doing more piracy. Okay, the problem is there are many examples that are not so preposterous, but where the argument for causation is equally weak. Okay, so why does this matter for policy? Let's think about two hypotheses here. One hypothesis is the relationship that we observe between speech and wages is causal. Okay, what happens then? Well, suppose then we have standard speech instruction, standard language instruction. Some people do it. Standard English becomes a more readily available tool. They speak it more. By virtue of speaking it more, their wages go up. Right? The policy gets the desired response. What if that relationship isn't causal? What if there's something else about these people's backgrounds, something that I haven't been able to control for, that contributes both to the way they sound and to their productivity in the labor market? Well, then what happens? Then we get people to take special language instruction, they use the standard more, and nothing happens to their wages. Right? We spent good money for nothing. Okay, so this question, as basic as it is, precedes, I think, any discussion of policy response to anything we're interested in. Okay, market failures. Okay, market failures are interesting. We study them a lot in the economics classes because they justify intervention on economic efficiency grounds. What are these things? These things go by the name of externalities, public goods, asymmetric information. Those are the three categories of market failures. An example of an externality is pollution. I pollute, I make profits by making whatever it is that pollutes, the pollution harms you. Public goods, the leading example here is national defense. Once I provide national defense for one, I've provided the same amount of national defense for all. Asymmetric information arises in insurance markets. I know more about my health than the company from which I'm buying insurance. Does speech seem analogous to any of these things? No. So I don't think we have a justification here based on market failures. That's okay, sometimes we redistribute. Sometimes the purpose of public policy is redistribution. You're not supposed to say this anymore. But it's true. Sometimes we take from the rich and we give to the poor. Now, one of the propositions that I hope you'll embrace by the time you leave here is that when we engage in redistribution, we should be doing so in the most efficient manner possible. One way to think about this is whether the policy is well targeted. If our goal is to tax rich people and give the revenues to people who aren't so rich, is speech a good marker for that, right? Should we be taxing people who speak standard English and giving money to people who speak non-standard English? Or would there be better mechanisms that are better targeted? Things like education, things like income, things like wealth. So the argument isn't just that we should be doing something to redistribute because there's one group that's worse off than the other. It needs to, the policy proposal needs to pass a higher test. It needs to be the best of the possible alternative. Is speech a good example? Turns out you can make a case it is. You can make a case it's not. This isn't the time to debate that. Okay. Finally, history. Once we've settled on policy, we've answered the questions to our satisfaction, I think we want to ask whether we've seen this before. And the reason is, at least in the case of speech, we have. We have offered, in some cases, we have mandated standard speech instruction. It has been met with tremendous resistance, probably because it was offered or mandated in a relatively insensitive manner. Okay, but I think history needs to be an important guide once we've answered these other questions. Okay, so let me conclude. I think when we're confronted with particularly situations which may seem unjust, it's tempting to jump to policy conclusions. I'm sorry. Okay, but sound policy requires that we answer sometimes difficult questions first. I would say that the aim of public policy education is to get future policy leaders to ask those questions first. And if you think in these terms by the time you leave here, then at least my aim of public policy education will have been achieved. So thanks.
Professor Grogger, why do you think this wage gap exists? Did you find any reasons in your research about why it exists?
Okay, so this is very preliminary. So I can't answer that question yet. There are a couple of explanations. If I were looking at different languages, so the case of migration, there's a pure productivity example, right? If I go to Mexico and I try to work there, my Spanish is so bad I can't do much. My productivity is limited. I don't really think that's what's going on here. I don't think either African American vernacular English or Southern American English is really an obstacle. So I think there's a couple things going on. So one is that speech is standing in for something which I haven't been able to capture. Another possibility is discrimination on the basis of speech. And I have hypothetical ideas for how I could sort that out, but I don't have data, so I'm not sure.
Just as a follow-up to that question, you mentioned that these were just two of the groups that you analyzed. Were there data from any other groups that would confirm some of those initial hypotheses?
Okay, so this is a great question. So I'm focusing here on African Americans and white Southerners. And actually, I should say Southern-sounding speech, okay? Now, the reason I do that, there are two reasons. One, these dialects are widespread. There are lots of people who speak them, and they are salient. People notice. Now, there's lots of other dialectical variation in American English. The Northeast, for example, has all sorts of dialectical variation. There's Pak and the Ka, and there's stuff like this, right? The problem is, given, there are two problems. One is, given the size of the survey, I don't have many speakers of those dialects. And the other thing is, I'm not sure how salient they are. I'm not sure how well my listeners are going to identify dialects like that. So I'm working with these two dialects that I have. I'd like to generalize this, but I'm not sure how to do that.
Can you provide any examples where causation and correlation are rigorously proved and where that influences public policy?
Anybody else want to respond to that? Okay, so there are all sorts of good examples. Sometimes we run experiments. Sometimes we can analyze data using quasi-experimental methods and make a very strong case for causation. The welfare reform work that I did now 20 years ago was a case where I think that the research had a pretty solid impact on policy. So I think it is possible to do research in a way that draws causal inferences, and I think that there are times when policy listeners listen to that.
I have two questions. The first one is, was the survey based on jobs on the north of the United States or all across the United States? And the second one was, if the jobs were personal attending or attention with the clients directly or based on a computer work? Also.
Okay, so more good questions. So first off, these jobs are all over the United States. So in most of the analyses I showed you, I controlled for the region where people live. We know that so there's a regional variation in wages. Now, I have done some work on this other question, what kind of jobs are these? I thought this was going to be really important. But it turns out what I did is you can classify occupations in various ways. There's one occupational classification that gives you like 20 different occupations. It turns out I can control for 20 different occupations, and this stuff doesn't go away. It doesn't really even change very much. Now, so there's more that I can do. There's more data on the sort of tasks that people do on the job. I need to learn how to work with that stuff. But so right now, it doesn't look like, at least at the level I've been able to look at, this isn't strictly about an occupational sorting story. It seems like some of that has to be going on here, but at least at the level I've been able to look at it, that's not what explains the result.
You talk about jumping to policy conclusions. Sometimes policymakers and advocates probably like the fact that the public misinterprets data or research because it supports whatever their policy objective is. So when putting out research like this, it's great to train us to be critical thinkers, but then what's the responsibility in making sure either how you're disseminating your analysis or just sharing that information to the kind of the broader public dialogue?
Oh, this is an excellent question. We were discussing this today. So I'll go one step farther. I think there are times when people use data without understanding its limitations. And I'd go so far as to say there are sometimes people use data with full knowledge of its limitations, but in the hopes it'll carry the day anyway. I'm not real cynical, but you know. So here's the question. One of the things that I hope you'll get out of the next 2 years is a lot of training, both formal statistical training, but also just ways of thinking about data, ways of thinking about analyses, ways of thinking about what the inferences are that you can draw from a particular study, from a particular news story, and so on. And then I think it's incumbent on you, with this knowledge, to push back against that sort of thing. Basically, make the case. Like, why are these three studies really not the good evidence on the other side of the issue? And why should other information carry? Or why should we be listening to stuff, you know, if somebody told you, look, the unfortunate thing is that most examples are not as extreme as pirates and global warming, okay? But there are a lot of things out there that logically are the same as pirates and global warming. And they just aren't as obvious. And so I think that it will be one of your jobs to push back against that kind of facile analysis and ask for people to think more seriously about this stuff. And hopefully, one of the things you'll get out of the next 2 years is some of the tools to help you with that.
You chose to focus on male workers. I was curious if, or as to why, and then also if there was any indication in your research as to whether or not this held true across genders.
Okay, so I don't know this. The reason is, so it turns out, this may or may not be a satisfying answer, but so it turns out it's customary in the labor economics literature to focus on men. And the reason, and remember that these men are about 30 years old. And the reason is, as complicated as the lives and work histories and so on of men are, Women, particularly this age, become more complicated still. There's things like having babies, there's things like stopping out of the labor market, getting back into the labor market, and this sort of stuff. And that additional complication makes it even harder to draw solid inferences. And so that's why, for the most part, we limit analysis to men. I haven't even looked at the data for women yet.
So I'll give a brief preamble, but I used to work for a company within our recruiting department. They used to not hire people based on whether or not they sounded like they're from the South or from the Midwest. And I was curious as to what was your sample size. I may have missed it because I came in a little bit late, but.
So I think I have like 5,000 wage observations in the sample.
Okay.
And so that's very interesting. That was explicit. That wasn't
that
a.
That was it, somewhat explicit. A number of people who were recruiters, I guess during their training process, they were told that if that person sounded too Southern or if they had somewhat of an accent, that they probably weren't likely to be hired within the company.
Can we talk further?
Yeah, we'll talk offline.
Thank you. Hi, so I've read about studies that have done, sounds like something similar, but with names in terms of resumes. And I was just wondering if you had looked at those studies to inform your study on speech, and also, if so, how would you go about proving that this speech issue was actually just a marker for prejudice? Thank you.
Yeah, so names. I don't have names. Can I get names? Okay, I think that's a mystery that is going to be hard to resolve. So the question is, so if I understand the question right, the question is, could this be, so this is Levitt and others published a study looking at names, distinctively African-American names, as I recall. And they found associations with disadvantage, sort of, you know, disadvantage outcomes down the road. And could this be part of that? I can't rule that out. And I'm told by my data guru that I'm never going to be able to rule it out. Dan Black, by the way, is the principal investigator for the survey. So that's why I'm looking at him, hopefully.
It seemed like the causality in that study was saying that names were standing in for, in some ways, this is a person who's Black, and they were able to make that assumption based on names. I was just wondering if there's any way you were talking about that as a possible causal factor that's acting beyond this. Is that something that you're looking to prove, and how would you do that?
So if I remember this right, they were trying to say that names was sort of a proxy for socioeconomic disadvantage. And so the one thing I can say is that's something I'm trying to condition on directly. So when I get to that sort of final column of results, there I'm controlling for things like whether you grew up in a two-parent family, your mother's education, your father's education, your family income when you were a kid, whether you attended a Catholic school, lots of stuff like that, which I think are probably more direct measures of socioeconomic disadvantage. Can I rule out that this has to do something with names? No.
Hi, I have a question for the chart with the wage gap on the Southern dialect. And I was wondering, the wage premium actually increases for people who don't have a dialect but are Southern, right? So do you have an explanation, the more you even control for factors like education, socioeconomic background, it goes even further up. Do you have an explanation for that?
No, so I don't, and here's why. So the observation here is that if we focus just on the Southerners who don't sound Southern, they actually earn slightly more, about 4 or 5% more than the non-Southern white reference group. And the reason I don't have an explanation for that, it turns out that itself is not statistically significant. So it's not, you can't draw a reliable inference, you know, that sort of if you looked at, you know, any given sample, you'd find the same result. The thing that's significant is the speech-related premium, not necessarily each of the two bars independently. So I don't have a story. Oh, sure. Most of the time, people don't think I speak too loudly.
So you showed that the market was responding in states where, for the African-American dialect, there was more of a premium. But given that, right at the beginning, you said that dialect is formed when you're a child versus wages are for adults, basically, how is that happening, or how is the market reacting, or how are they changing their dialect, or are they training children in that area to have a different dialect.
Well, so the story I would tell is this has something, I mean, you're exactly right. So this has to be something, whatever investment is being made in standard speech, favored speech, has to be made when the kid is, say, 8 years old. So I think this points to a role for mom and dad. Now, what's interesting, the thing that I didn't show is if I look at the model for Southerners, so there, I'm controlling for things like mom's education, dad's education, and so on. If I look at the model for Southern whites, dad's education matters a lot. Now, dad's education doesn't matter anything else. It doesn't help explain wages, but it helps explain favored speech. So I think that's suggestive of whether we want to take that seriously, whether it's education per se, whether that's telling us something about, you know, households, you know, more advantaged households promoting this type of speech. I think there's something like that going on.
Thank you.
All right, let's please join me in thanking Professor Grogger for his remarks. Thank you.
Thanks.